Hi guys, I'm Franz, a German spy. Welcome back to episode 2 of what I think I'm now going to call Demon Souls in Depth. I think in depth is probably a good name for it because that's the plan. I'm going to be getting a little bit more in depth with the lore and the story and the mechanics and a lot of the other things that are going on in this game. So we're picking back up here at episode 2 with Franziska in 1-2. And I'm going to get into... I want to show off all 4 builds on this account, but this one isn't finished yet. I put 2 levels into her intelligence so that she could use Soul Ray in addition to Fire Spray. Unfortunately, it seems I did not learn Second Chance on her first cycle. So that is going to be a bit of a problem for her until I get to the second area of the Shrine of Storms and defeat the old hero. So I'm going to have to play it real careful until then. Hopefully I'll do a little bit better with her than I did in the first episode, because I hope that this playthrough does not consist of just me dying and humiliating myself all the time. So she began as a level 1 hyper mage, and that was what I did for my entire first playthrough of this game with her. Got a lot of requests to level her up, show off some spells for spells that are accessible only with more intelligence slots. So that's what I'm going to do. I think I'm going to stick with Hyper Mage build for her all the way, because I'd like to be able to show you guys both ranged and melee strategies for some of the bosses, and all 3 of the other characters on this account are melee builds, strictly melee. So this is going to be really the only ranged build that I have. So I'm going to use her, I think, for 1-2 and maybe Stonefang, maybe the first area of Stonefang 2-1. So this is what I've got so far. Her equipment... basically what I got my first cycle, built up the sticky short bow plus 5, got a bunch of heavy arrows left over from my first run, so I'm going to just be using those. I'm going to be comparing and contrasting the damage from a bow in hyper mode to spells in hyper mode. And I think maybe this is the best opportunity to do it. I've got her configured to use the bow. Got the thief's ring so that enemies don't start sniping me from too far off. And then of course the clever rat's ring and the Morian blade for hyper mode. So let's see how much damage I can do to this Legion. Wasn't able to get around his guard. Gonna have to sneak past and hit these guys from behind, I'm afraid. I was fairly sure that you could get at their sort of like foot, the bottom part of them, from the front or the side, but I guess you absolutely have to be behind them. That's unfortunate. Alright, well, I'm just going to run straight through here, because there's another one off behind me. And, let's see... 301. Not bad. Not bad at all. Alright. Oh, right, there is something very important that I forgot. I've got to keep reminding myself not to just blow through all this stuff, because the whole point of this run is to talk a little bit about the mechanics and not just skip all the stuff I don't care about. So, that being the case, I'm going to sneak back down here. And it seems Brostrava is in trouble yet again.
Hello? You yonder. Over here. It's me, Ostrava. Look at me. Again surrounded by evil warriors. Could you, perhaps... help me one last time? Clear out the soldiers at the far end of this passage, if it pleases you.
I guess
the Lord's path,
me.
Just down yonder, has degenerated into a feeding ground for flying dragons. Have your wits about you.
Okay. Well, off to save Ostrava again. I swear, that guy is worse than freaking Princess Peach. He's always getting himself in trouble. Alright, now... as soon as you walk out through this doorway, that dragon over there is gonna just swoop down and start breathing fire. So I'm gonna show you guys, the cutoff is exactly this spot. If you take even a step or two forward... okay, well, right about here, in any case. But I'm going to have the dragon clear out the rubble over there first, so that I can just make a quick run through. Alright, well, I thought it was right about here. I think you have to be past the line of those rocks over here, maybe. Yeah, there we go. So the dragon will come down, he'll breathe fire along the path. There are three sections of the path. There's this first section, there's the second section over between those two towers, and then there's the final section after the second tower. And you can make a run for it immediately after the dragon begins his swoop. However, as a hyper mode build, it is possible to just get rid of the dragon right off the bat. The easiest way to do that is to stand right about here, aim your bow up at the tower, and as soon as you hear his cry, shoot an arrow at him. Now, I think I might have... Yes, good, I do. I have some white arrows left over from my first playthrough. You only get about 30 per run. I'm going to use these and see if they do any better damage to this thing. Yeah, much better. Almost twice as much. White arrows are the very best kind of arrow in the game, but you only get a limited number of them per playthrough, so... you gotta really make them count. I'm gonna get this dragon most of the way dead here, and then I'm going to move forward one section and let him clear out the bridge in front of me, and then kill him. I think I missed with that. You do not want to miss with white arrows. You don't want to waste them. The dragon's quite a bit more durable in New Game Plus. Four arrows in hyper mode in your first cycle are usually enough to kill him. They do about 450 damage to him each. So I'm gonna just fast forward this, because this is gonna take a couple of minutes. You know what, actually, I think now is a good time to try an experiment. I'm going to hit him with Soul Ray instead and see how much damage that does. Okay, I guess I gotta be a little bit quicker on the timing for that. Whoa! Much, much better than that bow. My gosh. Alright, Soul Ray it is. I'm saving my white arrows. Well, one more shot and he's done. Actually, I don't want to kill him just yet, do I? No, I don't. Alright. So I'm going to hang out just here and wait for him to swoop down and take out all the dreglings on this bridge. Oh, I guess he can't see me from there. Gotta move up! There we go. Perfect. Alright. Did I get him? Nope. Did I get him that time? Nope. Got him that time. One or two more of those. Whoops, not enough MP. I think that did it. Yup! And now the dragon is out of my hair. Plenty of souls from that. Alright. Now, I do not understand what the deal is with this, but you can't lock on to this guy until either he starts coming down the stairs or you start going up the stairs. I think it just has to do with the terrain. I think it's a problem with your line of sight through the terrain there. But the axe guy up at the top there, fairly easily dealt with. I'm just going to switch to soul ray now. Come on, come on. Again with the terrain. That guy break the barrier. Damn it! Again with the freaking lock-on. For whatever reason, lock-on doesn't seem to work very well on top of this tower. Alright, one of these corpses, I think it might be this one, has a wooden catalyst. And you're going to want to pick that up if you are a royal and you started off with the silver catalyst, because the wooden catalyst has, although it does not give you the MP boost of the silver catalyst, it does have slightly higher magic adjust, so your spells will do more damage with it. And that's pretty important. I'm going to keep the second wooden catalyst because I think I'm going to turn it into an insanity catalyst since I'm going to be going hypermage with this build. I'm going to take off this stupid hat. This hat has gotten me killed so many times just because I can't see through the damn thing. Alright, going to put my thief's ring on because I am going to want it here. We have to sneak through this tunnel and avoid being shot by a bunch of crossbow guys, as well as avoid some ambushes like this. Some really stupid ambushes. Now I am going to switch back to my bow. Oh crap, I'm still using white arrows. I don't want to waste those. Switch back to my heavy arrows. Yeah, and you see those crossbow guys over there. Gonna get the drop on them before they get the drop on me. And that is one of the things that the Thief's Ring is really helpful for. Whoop. Little bit too close. Couple more of them in there too, just past these guys. Can't quite see through that stupid item though. There they are. You can get them to turn around if you shoot an arrow in front of them. Of course, I just wasted that opportunity. That guy, and there goes that guy. All right, we're done here. So now we can rescue Brostrava.
Thank you. That makes twice. Thanks to you, I can now forge ahead. This is a token of my gratitude. Please accept it.
And Ostrava very generously gives us some dark moon grass. That is the best healing item in the game. It fully restores your health and cures every negative status. You only are given a limited number of them throughout the game. You can buy limited numbers from merchants, but you can farm them from the plague goblin guys in the Valley of Defilement, although they're an incredibly rare drop. Usually those guys just drop Crescent Moongrass or some other weaker variant. And you can hear already dogs barking down at the other end of the corridor here, and that is going to portend a very nasty ambush. Not that ambush, though. That ambush was just cheesy. Okay, well, I guess my reaction time on that ambush was not as quick as it should have been. Okay, so I came back to talk to Ostrava because he has some kind of interesting dialogue once you rescue him here.
This is bad. Not a single person left. Why on earth? How did all of this happen? Father!
So, it's pretty clear that Ostrava has not been in Boletaria until recently because he's not familiar with the situation and he seems very surprised by the fact that things have reach the point that they're at now. So he is not up to speed on current events in Boletaria. Alright, now what I should have done here was locked onto him from a distance, not gone into manual aiming mode, and just done that. And that's really illustrative of the need to pay attention in this game, because if you don't pay attention, you end up experiencing a lot of pointless, needless, stupid deaths. Speaking of which, these dogs over here, they would be attacking me by now if I didn't have the thief's ring on, but there are five of them over there, and if you just charge blindly in there, they will tear you to shreds. They're very swift, they attack very quickly, and right after they attack, they dodge right out of your range so you can't hit them. So the best way to deal with them is just to use ranged attacks from outside their aggro range. And once they're dead, you can safely pass. Now, over here, there is a single guy guarding where the merchant has set up his shop. So let's have a word with the merchant and see what he's got to sell us.
Ah, we meet again. Fancy that. Hope you find something that suits you. It is the end of... But hell!
Heard that already.
The giant lizard! One of the king's pets, just like those demons. That monster leaves a trail of charred carcasses, which is great for business, of course. But unless you're a scavenger like me, you better stay clear.
Well, fortunately for us, that problem is out of the way.
It is the end of...
Alright, now, when he moves to this location, he's upgraded his inventory slightly. You can now buy, I think, late moongrass you can buy, which I don't believe he had before. He has also added a claymore and a broadsword to his inventory. The claymore is basically an upgraded version of the bastard sword. It has slightly higher stat requirements, but also does slightly more damage, and is slightly heavier. The broadsword is a very interesting weapon. It's a straight sword, and it has the straight sword moveset, but it inflicts bleed damage, which makes it completely unique among straight swords, because no other straight sword has a bleed effect on it. So this is, it's still an inferior weapon when fully upgraded compared to some of the other weapons that you get later on in the game, but early on it's not too bad, especially if you are a fan of damage over time. He now sells regular bolts in addition to wooden bolts, but again, both are equally useless because crossbows are crap in this game, and he still sells the plate armor.
Hard times, eh? I'm sure you'll turn things around.
He's awfully cheerful, isn't he? I gotta hand it to him. He's managing to stay pretty optimistic in spite of all the crazy stuff going on in Boletaria. Alright, so when you come up here, there are gonna be a couple of crossbow guys right over there, so get rid of them. This corpse here has the compound shortbow. and a couple of heavy arrows on it as well. I don't believe I have the strength to use this yet, though. No, I don't. 18. I'd need at least 12 strength to be able to use it. The interesting thing about bows in this game, and they fixed it in Dark Souls, but a bow requires two hands in order to use it. So what they neglected to consider was that the strength requirement for the bow is actually effectively only only two-thirds of what's actually shown. So this bow requires 18 strength, but because you have to hold it two-handed anyway in order to be able to use it, you only need 12 strength to hold it. The bows in Dark Souls, in Demon Souls, with the exception of the white bow, I guess they, for some reason, they did think of it with the white bow, but the bows in Demon Souls actually are affected by the strength bonus from two-handing a weapon. So, yeah, very interesting. So you only need about two-thirds of the stated strength requirement that a bow has on its status screen in order to use the bow effectively. So I need 3 more points of strength in order to be able to use it. Now what I'm going to do from up here is there are a couple of dreglings down there. I'm going to just get rid of them from here. Got to aim slightly to the right if you're going to not use manual aim mode. There we go. And then that one I can hit. And that one I can hit. Ah. There. All right. So now I am going to... Can I reach them? Nope. I can't. Can I reach him? Nope. I can't. I can reach him that way. Can he see me? He can, but he doesn't seem to want to attack. Kill him. Just so that they don't snipe me from behind, because you cannot turn your back on enemies in this game. Alright, now at this point I am going to switch to the magic build, because I do not want to have to stand still. There's a couple of guys up there on the battlement who are going to be shooting crossbow bolts at me. Clear out those guys as soon as possible so that I have room to maneuver here. There. Alright, and now I no longer need the Thief's Ring, so I can switch it out for the Ring of Magical Sharpness and regain my damage bonus. Come on, you! There we go. Now, up here is going to be our first Crystal Lizard. These work the exact same way in Demon Souls that they do in Dark Souls. If they see you, they will run away, and if you leave them alone after that, they will disappear. However, whereas in Dark Souls, they would just respawn when you reload the game, if you allow a Crystal Lizard in Demon Souls to disappear, it's gone for good, and it will not respawn indefinitely. Each Crystal Lizard only respawns up to a maximum of 4 times, or 5 in the case of the Crystal Lizards in Boletaria, because there are 4 areas in Boletaria rather than 3. So, the way it works is, each time you defeat a boss, all of the Crystal Lizards in that area will be given another spawn. So, before defeating any bosses, the Crystal Lizards will only spawn once, and then they will not respawn. When you defeat one boss, they'll respawn a second time. You defeat a second boss, they'll respawn a third time. So, do not waste Crystal Lizard spawns. If you do not want to kill one, stay away from it and don't aggro it. So these are the two assholes who are raining crossbow bolts down on us. The treasure up here is not stuff I particularly care about. There's a stone of ephemeral eyes, there are a couple of souls, and I think a lotus or two. But there's nothing important up here. So we are going to head back down. Now, before we enter the fog, there is, I believe it's on this stretch of the bridge, there is a spike shield out here somewhere, I think. I think it's on one of these corpses. Not that one. It might be a little bit earlier on, but I'm pretty sure it's out here. Let me just head out here and clear out the dreglings. One more. Alright. That's just a soul. What about this? Another soul. I think it might actually be on the first stretch of bridge. Here. I never pick up the spike shield, so I sometimes forget where exactly it is. There it is. Okay, it was on the second. Ah, damn it, I didn't see that guy. Well, anyway, now you know where the spike shield is. Alright, anyway, so as I was saying, the spike shield, if I can find it in here, where is it? There it is. The spike shield is actually a pretty decent shield. Unlike the one that you get from Darkwraith Kirk in Dark Souls, this one does block 100% physical damage, and it's also useful as a weapon. So you can actually, this does a very good deal of stun locking, so I've actually seen people use this in PvP on troll builds to stunlock people to death. So, it's much more useful in this game than it is in Dark Souls. Alright, anyway. Let's head into the boss room. And actually, just a quick side note, this door here, we're gonna need to get a key from 1-3 before we can open that, but Bjor is down there. Alright, so I find that the safest thing to do is actually to run directly either under the Tower Knight's legs off the bat or just around him at his feet. Because if you run too far to his side, he will often be able to hit you with his horizontal slash. That guy out. And that guy. And run around this way. This corpse just has some grass on it. Take that guy out. that guy. Finally, this guy. What? What's going on here? Oh, I was hitting a wall. I thought for some reason that guy had turned invincible or something. I got pretty scared for a minute there. Alright, let's do a quick comparison here. Let's see the difference in damage between Fire Spray. One fireball from Fire Spray does 134 damage. Let me just make sure I'm wearing everything I need. Yes, I am. And one Soul Ray does 646. Okay, I think I'll stick with Soul Ray. And there it is, guys. It's the exact same fight it is in your first cycle, just he has more hit points, and his minions are a little bit more difficult to kill. Well, more importantly, his minions do a little bit more damage if they hit you, but... So there you go. Now, I am going to ditch this stupid hat, which I hate bitterly. I'm going to switch back to the Storm Ruler. Going to head back to the Nexus. And now we're going to be able to get some very interesting dialogue with Brostrava. But first, I'm going to put away the spike shield, because I did not get it in my previous playthrough. I don't expect I'm going to be using it, but keep it on hand just in case. We'll put those things away. We'll put that away. And we'll keep that. I think everything else is good.
We.
All right. So, first of all.
Well, you found yourself a demon soul, did you? I'm impressed. Yes, indeed I am. Stay the path. And you will soon be a monster yourself. Can't you see you've fallen for their trap?
So even in Demon Souls, even before Dark Souls existed, they're making very strong allusions to the fact that relying too much on the power of demons and having the Maiden in Black over there pump too much demon juice into you can result in you turning into a demon yourself. So... It's a very interesting parallel. They mention that you lose your humanity if a demon steals your soul, and that's also kind of a central theme in Dark Souls as well as this game.
You. Have you seen my corporeal flesh? Has my body gone rotten?
I wish I knew how to answer that question.
I'm sorry. Please leave me alone.
Okay, you can just sit over here on your corner and cry. I'll just be out saving the world.
Be thankful.
Nothing new there. Might as well repair my stuff, though.
Thank goodness, I was worried. If only something could be done to help. We are indebted.
Alright, now... I think there's a little bit more dialogue with the Umbasa lady. I'm going to go talk to her before we speak with Ostrava.
Have you heard? If you are attacked by a demon, you will lose your humanity. What a horrible thought. Just what would happen then? I simply cannot fathom it. Umbasa.
So... There, again, is our outright statement that being attacked by a demon causes you to lose your humanity. So it seems more or less analogous to going hollow in Dark Souls.
Masa.
Neither one of these guys has any new dialogue. Not until we rescue Saint Urbane, anyway. And I do not believe that Frake's apprentice will either, but...
Are you begging? Frake is a great sage who systemized the magic of the soul arts to make it possible for human imitation. By observing the state of Boletaria and the demons within it, he's likely to pave the way for greater things. All the more reason that I must meet Frake as soon as possible.
So I can't remember if I addressed that in the previous episode or not, but Frake is the one who is solely responsible for figuring out a way for humans to imitate the soul arts, which is the magic that demons use.
Me? Without doubt, I made my best effort to save Sage Frake. But I had not the strength. It's as simple as that. Besides, if I myself were captured, who would stand here and recruit rescuers?
The fact of the matter is, rescuing Sage Frake from 3-1 does not require a great deal of strength, as evidenced by the fact that I did it at Soul Level 1 in the previous playthrough. It does, however, require some brains, which apparently this guy does not have.
I see.
So, enough with that. It is time for a very, very, very large plot dump.
At its peak, Boletaria was a grand kingdom. The king, his knights, and his subjects were modest and plain, but also steadfast and compassionate. In the distant southern kingdom, Boletaria was known as paradise on earth. But look at what has become of us now. I refuse to believe that this is what Father wished for our great land.
So, quite a bit of information here. First of all, Ostrava implies that he was around during Boletaria's heyday. So he clearly spent some time here, he's familiar with it, and he speaks highly of the king and his subjects. He also mentions that the southern kingdom of Boletaria is a separate kingdom from the northern kingdom. And there's a little bit more evidence of that in the description of the fluted armor. For some reason, the fluted armor is called a helmet. I think that's just a glitch in the description. Or perhaps they just copy-pasted and didn't really pay attention to updating the copy-pasted description. But it says that the fluted armor is used by the knights of the relatively advanced region of southern Boletaria. So there are heavy implications that the southern region of Boletaria is ruled separately from the northern region. So the northern kingdom is ruled by King Alant, the southern region is completely separate and is not under the rulership of King Alant at all. So, any of the characters starting as the Knight class are implied to be knights from southern Boletaria who wander north and enter Boletaria through the fissure. Just a little interesting piece of lore there. Interesting to note that northern Boletaria is not the... it's a different area than southern Boletaria. And also that... The deep fog originates in northern Boletaria, but has not yet enveloped the south. And I guess actually now is a good time to point out that as far as the different areas of the world are concerned, these are not separate worlds, they're not separate dimensions. These are all different parts of the same world. So Stonefang is some distance away from Boletaria, Latria is some distance away from Boletaria, but they're not separate dimensions or separate worlds, they're just separate lands in the same world. And I'm going to go read the descriptions of the Archstones in just a moment, and that is going to help confirm that the areas are, they are in fact all in the same world, and God, I hate motorcycles. Ugh. And they are in fact contiguous. But not the areas in between are not accessible to us, because we can only warp to areas where there is an archstone from the Nexus. So the Nexus is in the center, as we learned from the Monumentals cutscene in the previous episode. And then surrounding the Nexus, in 6 different points around the world, are these archstones. The Broken Archstone is the Land of the Giants. We cannot go there because apparently they destroyed that archstone in order to prevent any of the evil that took over that land from seeping back into the Nexus through the archstone link. So, in any case, let's get some more dialogue with Ostrava. He's got quite a bit more to tell us.
Here in Boletaria, we speak of the legend of the Two Swords and the Last Hero. The Two Swords are Demonbrand and Soulbrand. One sword banishes that which befouls man, and the other banishes man himself. The last hero is Old King Doran. King Doran is the Everlasting One, founder of Boletaria and protector of the Two Swords. Of course, only according to legend. But in the dark state of our land, legends are all we can depend upon.
You know, all you guys would have to do is open the mausoleum and those legends would be proven true. So, there's not really much explanation required there. He just gave us some straight-up information about the Two Swords, Demonbrand and Soulbrand, as well as Old King Doran. So, we now know that Old King Doran is, in fact, the king who founded Boletaria. He is the first king of Boletaria. And he is apparently immortal. The description of his equipment actually refers to him as a demigod. So let's get the last little bit of dialogue, and now Ostrava is going to tell us about the three the three demon bosses in Boletaria.
But in the dark...
Or maybe not.
But in the dark state...
Okay, well... perhaps we have to defeat another demon before we get that dialogue from Ostrava. In any case, let's check out the descriptions of the, the Archstones. A huge stone castle in the heart of the northern kingdom of Boletaria. Hungry soldiers whose souls have been stolen by demons attack trespassers, and terrible dragons nest there. Pretty self-explanatory. Past the huge Boletarian castle gates lies the cliff pathway, now a feeding ground for dragons, which leads to the inner ward where the knights live. So that entire first section of Boletaria that we went through before we fought Phalanx, that was just the gate into the kingdom. Inside Boletaria's gates, where the streets intertwine, lies a trap set by the Fat Official, an embodiment of Old King Alant's madness. Now this is interesting because the Fat Official's hat describes them as... I can actually go read it, I don't remember the exact words, but it says that they... I'll find it out in just a moment. Fat ministers, who appeared just before demons ran rampant in Boletaria and ingratiated themselves with King Alant, oppressed the masses with sly grins. This hat is said to have been resented by the masses as a hateful reminder of them. So, the fat ministers were around slightly before the demons, and as the Umbasa lady told us, King Alant left on some strange business and returned with horrible demons in tow. So, as far as I can piece together from that timeline, the fat ministers showed up in Boletaria, persuaded King Alant to leave with them, and then he came back with all those demons with him and started taking over Boletaria. So that's the sort of timeline that I've been able to piece together from that information. Now, the description of the Stonefang Archstone is interesting as well. City of the Borrowers, keepers of the huge tunnel. Most of the stubborn excavators who supported the soldiers of Boletaria had their souls taken. Lacking their own will, they mindlessly continue working. Stonefang is allied with Boletaria, or at least they have some kind of trade agreement going with them, because there are, I believe, one or two Boletarian soldiers in Stonefang, if I remember correctly. I think there are a couple of crossbow guys in there. Or if not, if I'm misremembering it, at the very least, there are a number of dead soldiers and knights in there who would appear to have been from Boletaria. And also, let me see if I can find it. I think I have... Oh, I was hoping I had a knight sword. Maybe I have a knight shield. I do not. In any case, the descriptions of the knight sword and the knight shield say that they are made from stone fangs hardened iron. So, the equipment used by the Knights of Boletaria is forged actually in stone fang. So, just an interesting piece of lore there. There is a definite allegiance and relationship between Stonefang and Boletaria, and there actually seems to be some sort of covert activity by the Boletarian spies in Latria here. And we're going to find out a little bit more about that once we start exploring 3-1. But we find a couple of corpses in 3-1 that have equipment on them used by the spies of Boletaria, and we also find Lord Ridiel in a prison cell in Latria, and Lord Ridiel is referred to as Little Alant. His character description, I think it's in the instruction manual of the game, says very clearly that he is from Boletaria. So there are definite agents of Boletaria in Latria, and Ridiel himself also refers to a retainer to the king, which is King Alaunt, who once held the key to the cell that he's trapped in, and he refers to the retainer as an ebony swine with a gluttonous swaying belly, which is very clearly talking about a fat minister. So these three kingdoms are, they're connected by activity within each kingdom. Each of these two kingdoms seems to have a relationship with the others. So, very interesting stuff going on there. The Shrine of Storms and the Valley of Defilement, on the other hand, they seem to be much farther removed from the three kingdoms on this side of the world, and there does not seem to be a direct relationship between any of the other areas and the Shrine of Storms. The Shrine of Storms, particularly, is actually, it's on an island. You can look around from the shrine and see that it's completely surrounded by ocean. So, no activity from anybody there except Grave Robber Blige. The Valley of Defilement, there is some question. It seems that all of the rot of the world, living or not, ends up there, according to the merchant who lives there. There are apparently other people who live there as well, whom we never see. But the three kingdoms, or at the very least, Balataria and Stonefang, and probably Latria as well, seem to use the Valley of Defilement as a garbage dump. So my guess is that the Valley of Defilement is located equidistant between the three of them. That's just the impression that I get. Again, they don't really give us any concrete evidence, so we can't pin it down for certain. We have to draw our own conclusions and make our own interpretations. That's just my take, based on the information that we are given. So, I think we have now gotten all of the dialogue that we can for the time being. So I think what I'm going to do is just cut it here. Next, I'm going to do Stonefang, and I think I'm going to level Franziska up a little bit and see if I can't clear Stonefang as well. So thank you all for joining me for episode 2 of this playthrough, and I will see you all next time.